annual event that we have for ladies in the triad. We're very excited to have Miss Clara from the War Room. Karen Abercrombie will be here as our special guest. Very thrilled to have her. There are tickets available tonight. They are $15 out in the lobby, and ladies, that'll get you in next week. That starts at 6:30 next Saturday night. You can also get tickets at the door, but they'll be $20. You'll do much better to get those tonight, and we would certainly invite you to come back for Winter Blues, ladies, next Saturday night. Now, I want to take a moment and just introduce my good friend, Nate Kingsbury. He's the pastor at Shady Grove Wesleyan Church, and he's going to kick things off for us.
Are you excited to hear Dr. Tony Evans today? Amen. We had an awesome privilege to see him this morning with a bunch of men for breakfast. And then he got to speak to a bunch of us leaders in this whole area this afternoon. And I want to just say this, that God is moving in a mighty and wonderful way. And he is going to move in your life today. And I just want to encourage you guys to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. And as God anoints this man to speak these words over us today, that your hearts will be open to hear from the Lord. And I promise you today, if your hearts are open and willing to hear from the Lord, that God is going to do an amazing work in your life tonight. And I just want to pray, just ask God to be here, the Holy Spirit to fill this place. And I am praying that lives will be changed. So let's just pray for a second, okay? Dear God, we love you and we thank you, God, for how awesome you are. You're such a wonderful God. And God, we lift this night up to you and we invite your presence to be in this place in such a special way. God, you're the one that can change hearts today. You're the one, God, that can fill this place with your presence, God. And God, we can be changed by the power of God. So right now, ahead of time, God, I pray right now that you'll be with Dr. Evans, that you'll anoint his words, that you'll use them, that you'll be with our worship, that you will be in every aspect of this service, God. Because you are an amazing God. And you want to work in us. And you want to change us. And you want to move. We love you, Jesus, and we praise you in your name. Amen. I want to let you know that I just want to give a big hand to First Christian. There's just a white piece of paper on there, and that's an information sheet. We just want to hear from you. We want to hear what God has done in your life. One of the biggest things for Roy, who is in charge of this event, is we want to see and hear how lives were changed. Like if someone recommitted their life, or if they're called to go to the mission field, or God did something. So we want to encourage you to grab those sheets and fill that information out so that we can keep you guys familiarized with all the into this ministry. And God's alive and he's going to work tonight. And I've asked Roy to come on up here. And Roy, I want you to know something about this man. He's made this whole weekend possible. Can we give him a hand right now? I want you to hear this. Roy has a huge heart to see the walls of denomination, racism, to be completely broken down, and to see true reconciliation take place, and to see men and women step up and lead their home spiritually. I've watched Roy from this morning in the breakfast to this afternoon as Dr. Evans talked to all the men and leaders of churches. And I saw God just break Roy's heart down with tears coming down his eyes. He wants to see God do something incredible in this area. And this has been his dream, and his dream is coming alive. And Roy, we want to hear from you. We want to hear what God's doing in your life and how this dream kind of came about. We love you, man. We want to hear from you. Can we give him a hand one more time?
Well, for several years, my wife was nudging my heart that I needed to be a man of action and a leader of the family. And in 2005, God woke me up one Saturday morning and said, "What have you done for the kingdom?" And there was nothing measurable that I could hand out. It would have all been consumed in the fire of judgment. And I said, "Lord, I've done nothing to serve you." And he put a fire in my heart and said, "You need to get moving." My children were young enough and coachable and moldable at that point in time that I still had an opportunity to make a difference. And I got to work. I picked up the phone and called a friend. I said, hey, I need some help, who was my pastor from a previous time, and he came alongside. It's now 12 years later, going on 13 years later, and the point is, when you invest in someone, God can make a difference. It's not about your position. It's not about your income. It's about being willing to step forward. And as God moved this morning, I can't even describe it to you. And Nate is my pastor, and I forgot to tell him that was shared in confidence about the broken heart. But no, that's perfectly all right. It's all for God's kingdom. But what happened today was just God started to peel back the onion, and there's something coming. I can't quite put my arms around it yet, but it's just that we truly have to love one another. And if we can't do it as a body of Christ, how will the world ever know how it's modeled? So God must be sitting up there, just crying, saying, I sent my son to die for you for what? Have you not learned as the body of Christ? And I'm just here to ask you tonight to reach over, stand up, reach over, hug somebody that you don't even know and say, I love you, and you're my brother and sister in Christ. After prayer. So now don't you feel so much better? So my charge to you is, if you're a man or woman and you want to make a difference, plug in with us and somewhere. And Dr. Evans will talk about that. I shared with him, I said, the greatest challenge is getting everybody plugged in. And he gave a great vision, and you're going to be totally amazed tonight at how God uses him. So with that, I just want to say from the bottom of my heart, and from all the volunteers who've made this possible, this is not a one-person show. God had it first, and all the foot soldiers were behind, and I just get to have the biggest shoulders to help lead this thing. So, let's all stand up, and let's give our God honor. I'll say a quick prayer, and then we'll turn it over to Landy. He'll open us up in worship, and Pastor, if you'll go back and take care of Dr. Evans. And Father, only you know the hearts of your people. Only you know the hearts. May we be the people that you would want us to be, Lord, so that you will be proud of us rather than sad for us. May we love those that need to be loved. May we help those that need to be helped, Father. And may we make disciples of all the nations like you've asked us to do. The greatest charge is to love our neighbor, which means everyone, Lord. Not physically the person next door, but everyone. And Father, as we're going through difficult times in our country, I just pray that the church becomes the catalyst, and this group of people here tonight become the catalyst for Triad. And Lord, I just thank you to be able to serve you. And the part I didn't share on the story tonight, Lord, you could have taken me home on several different occasions, and you saved me. And I just thank you for that and for allowing me to be an influence on my family and to be able to serve you. And I ask that each man and woman here tonight would equally be charged and leave here energized to do the same if they're not already doing that, Father. It's in your Son's precious and holy name. We give you all the honor and all the glory. And God's people said,
amen.
Landy, take it away.
All right, one more time, everybody. Why don't you just put your hands together and let's give God praise. We're going to sing about his love. Come on, put your hands together. Oh, yeah. There was between us by the cross you
name and broke the names around the light. You called my name and there's greater. Your love is stronger. Awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. All the dead are coming back to life. You believe it? I'm back to life. I hear the song awaken. Our creation singing, we're alive. Because you're alive. You call me. You call me out of the grave. You call me into the light. You call my name and then my heart came alive. Yeah. Your love is greater. Your love is strong. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Say, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive cause you're alive. What a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. Come on, sing it out one more time. What a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive cause you're alive. Come on, clap your hand. Sing it together. Your love is greater. Yeah. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger.
That you've given us so freely. God, what a privilege and an honor it is to be here in your presence, celebrating who you are, all that you've done. God, we're so thankful for the cross of Christ tonight. God, it's why we're here. It's the reason we sing. It's the reason we rejoice. And we praise your name tonight, oh God. Amen. Oh.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My sin, his body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah stayed and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. Gates, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Thank you.
Church, say amen.
Amen.
Hey, high five somebody next to you and tell them, I'm ready to receive whatever God has for me. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. Yeah, yeah, yeah. High five the other person on the other side and say, get ready. It's coming. It's coming. All right, you may be seated. You may be seated. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our speaker for this evening. Dr. Tony Evans is founder and senior pastor of Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship in Dallas, Texas. It started out as 10 people in his home and has grown to nearly 10,000. He is also the founder and president of the Urban Alternative. He is the former chaplain of the NFL's Dallas Cowboys. I thought that might get mixed emotions. Y'all come back, come on back, come on back. And presently, he's the chaplain for the NBA's Dallas Mavericks. His Christian radio broadcast, The Alternative with Dr. Tony Evans, can be heard on nearly 1,200 radio outlets across the nation daily. Dr. Evans' sermons are also streamed and downloaded over 10 million times annually. Dr. Evans is one of the country's most respected leaders in the evangelical circles. As a pastor, teacher, author, and speaker, he serves the body of Christ through his unique ability to communicate complex theological truths through simple yet profound illustrations. While addressing the practical issues of the day, we experienced that this morning and this afternoon. Dr. Evans is known as a relevant expositor. In other words, he knows how to break down the scriptures. Come on, somebody. For new and for veteran and even leaders alike, we all regard him as a pastor of pastors, as a father in the faith. He is the husband to his lovely bride, Lois, a father to Crystal, Priscilla, Anthony Jr., and Jonathan, as well as a grandfather to 12 and a great-grandfather to 1. Can we get on our feet, put our hands together, and give a great big triad welcome and love to our brother and friend, Dr. Tony Evans.
Thank you. Now, no, I'm just kidding. Get out. Good evening, Triad. It is an honor, a privilege, and a joy to be with you. I heard that reaction to the Cowboys. I just want you to know, I ain't preaching nothing. No, just kidding. No, I'm humbled. You know, I'm humbled to be here. Thank you, Roy Jones, for inviting me. I'm humbled to be here, I got welcome to this snow. But I'm really humbled. You know, people from Texas are not known to be humble people, okay? Because, you know, in Texas, everything is like big. See, so Texans are not known to be humble people, but I am humbled to be here. Because, see, I don't want to be like the Texan who liked to brag about how big his ranch was. He just loved to brag about the size of his ranch. And so he would use any opportunity he could to brag. And if there was an opportunity, he would create one. He was in Europe one day. He ran across a European farmer. He said, well, this might be a great opportunity to brag. So he asked the European farmer how big his farm was. The European farmer said, well, just about 25 acres. He knew that the European farmer would then ask him how big his ranch was. Sure enough, the European farmer said, well, how big is your ranch? The Texas rancher cleared his throat. Said, well, it's like this. I get up before the sun rises, get in my truck, and when the sun sets, I've still not reached the end of my property. To which the European farmer said, yeah, I used to have a truck like that once. So pride cometh before the fall. I'm humbled to be here. Now, I know this is like the fourth year, Roy, fourth year or so, okay. And okay, so for the ladies, yes. Okay, because without them, we wouldn't be here. So this ladies are included. Actually, let me tell you how I got invited. Roy has this little committee, and they would, you know, they have to come up with a speaker every year. So it's the fourth year, it's kind of expanded, the ladies are invited, so the committee says, okay, let's get together and decide who we're going to invite. So Roy opens it up for people to make recommendations. So one of the committee members says, you know what? This is a very astute community. You know, we got Wake Forest here. We got people skilled and educated. It's growing. So we need an orator. This year we need an orator. Someone who can ethically construct himself with nest through the various that everyone will be just overwhelmed with the oratory. We need something that's really going to grab them. So they invited him, but he couldn't make it. So Roy said, well, are there any other suggestions? Another committee member said, well, like this. I think we need a spiritual intellect, somebody whose mind is sharp and whose knowledge of the Bible is rich. We need somebody whose understanding of pneumatology, ecclesiology, angelology, anthropology, and harmartiology will take us to the depth of the Word of God from the antediluvian age of Genesis through the revelatory epochs of the seven dispensations ending with the millennial kingdom, so that there's this comprehensive understanding of the Word of God. They invited him, but he couldn't make it either. Roy said, are there any other suggestions? Another one said, well, you know, let's get a name. Let's get somebody who, when we say he is coming, the people will want to come out just because of the name. But the same thing happened. They invited the name, he couldn't make it. So they had invited the orator, he couldn't make it. They invited the intellect, he couldn't make it. Invited the name. He couldn't make it. Well, that's when the leaders, Roy said, okay, wait a minute. We couldn't get the orator. We couldn't get the intellect. We couldn't get the name. But I know a good-looking preacher. But he couldn't make it either. So finally, he invited me. So I just couldn't see turning him down five times in a row. So I'm just honored for the privilege to be with you today. Obviously, I'm just kidding. I'm having a good time with you. I've had a good time all day. It started this morning with an intimate men's breakfast, and we had a good time with the men. And then we had a luncheon with leaders from the community, and that was exciting, challenging them about what's really going on in the world. And so kind of put a little different spin on some things, and so I'm here with you tonight, and then we get with the men only tomorrow morning. But I'm gonna hang around a little bit after this is over. They've got a bunch of my books that are here, and I'll stay around and sign some books and say hello to some folks as long as time will allow and be with you. But for right now, they've asked me to communicate with you. One of my most recent books is called Kingdom Disciples, and I thought I'd talk to you about that a lot because that's weighty on me. I talked about it, I intimated on it throughout the day, and so they've asked me to challenge us and talk to us from the Word of God. Communication is a challenge. We all live in contexts where communication can be difficult. It's the job of the encoder, that's the sender of the message, to reach the decoder, who is the receiver of the message. I'm going to ask God to help me to encode that which we decode and it be the same thing. Because communication can be easily misunderstood and mislost, and lost. You know, I want to be like the guy. He lived in Chicago, and it was like freezing in the middle of winter. And he lived in Chicago. He couldn't take the cold anymore. So he said, "Look, I'm going to Florida. I got to get away from this cold weather." His wife was away on a business trip, so he wanted to email her to tell her, "Don't come to Chicago. The weather's too bad. Just fly straight to Florida." But unfortunately, he forgot her email address. And instead of the email going to his wife, it went to a little old lady in Iowa. Now, this little old lady in Iowa was a pastor's wife. And her husband had just died the day before. So obviously, she's in mourning. She sees this mistaken email that's been sent to her. And when she reads it, she screams and then faints. So she's on the floor screaming. The other relatives who had shown up to comfort her rush in, see her laid out on the floor, wondering what had happened. And then they read the mistaken email that was sent to her, and then they understood. The first line said, "My dearest darling, just want you to know I have arrived safely." The second line said, "Looking forward to you joining me tomorrow." Signed, "Your loving husband. P.S. Sure is hot down here." So it's very important that that we communicate. Father, we laugh when we enjoy each other. Thank you for giving me new friends in this wonderful community, individually and collectively. Thank you for Roy Jones and the heart you've given him for men, and for the ladies who join us tonight as well. And prepare us for what you called us to. In Jesus' name, amen. April 14th, 1912. You know it as the day the Titanic sunk. one of the great tragedies of the 20th century. If I were to ask you, why did the Titanic sink? You would tell me it ran into an iceberg. And you would be partially correct. That day when it rammed into an iceberg, slitting its side, allowing the water to rush in, was indeed a tragic collision. But there is something that occurred prior to that that's not as well known, that was the preamble and prerequisite to the sinking of the Titanic. It involved a missing key. David Blair was the second officer assigned to the Titanic. It was inside the crow's nest locker were binoculars. That little semicircle at the top of the ship would use to look out to give him clarity about what was in the distance. But David Blair got reassigned on the day before the Titanic left. And he forgot to leave the key. So David Blair took the key to the crow's nest locker with him, leaving the locker locked with the binoculars inside. So the gentleman on the crow's nest locker looked out with only his eyes. For one reason or another, unable to retrieve the binoculars because of the missing key. And on that foggy evening, did not clearly see the danger ahead. And the net result was the Titanic on its maiden voyage hitting an iceberg and sinking. If it wasn't for that missing key, tragedy may have been averted. I would like to suggest to you today there is a missing key that is leading to the disasters that we are experiencing and seeing all around us. In our personal lives, in our destruction taking place in our families, the ineffectiveness of our churches, and the chaos in our society. There are icebergs all around us, things that folk are running into that are causing destruction and devastation and death and divorce and pain and problems and addictions and on and on and on. And we keep ramming into these icebergs. But if we could get this key, perhaps our sight line would change and tragedy averted. The key that I would like to suggest to you today, that I can only introduce, it's much more of it is in some of the material out there, but the key is the absence of disciples. Not the absence of Christians, but the absence of disciples. It is this missing key, when understood and properly applied, that is God's secret, if you will, to not only victorious life personally, but victorious impact. The dead. He called for a meeting. Jesus' resurrection and his ascension. Jesus had a number of meetings in the 40 days between when he arose and when he ascended. But he only scheduled one. Three groups attend the meeting. In Matthew 28, it says in verse 16 that the 11 disciples went to meet him at the place where he designated. at the mountain, he told them to meet him there. 11, that is minus Judas. So that's one group. According to 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus met with 500 brethren. So for 500 people to be in one place at the same time, it meant it had to be a planned gathering. So there are 500, give or take, because of the 11, who now gather at the mountain to meet with the risen Christ. There is a third group that attends the meeting. Because the end of Matthew 28 says, "And lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the age." Well, the age has not ended, so you and I are at the meeting. So why don't we all mosey on up the hill since we've been invited to find out what this meeting is about? This is called in the Bible, the great, in our Christian conversation, the Great Commission. There are five commissions in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. Each one of them has a commissioning by the risen Christ. But only this one includes the word disciple. That's why it's called the Great Commission. It says, when they gathered to meet him, the first thing they did, it says in verse 17 of Matthew 28, is that they worshiped him. So they had a worship service. They are paying homage to him, singing songs to him, praising him, adoring him. They are celebrating the greatness of the risen Christ. So they're worshiping. Something we do every single Sunday and in our personal devotional time, they worshiped him. But it throws in another phrase. It says, but some were doubtful. They were worshiping him with question marks. They were worshiping him, but some weren't sure about some things. And if the truth were being told and we were being radically honest today, some of us worship him with question marks. Is this as real as it seems? Is this as given what's happening in the world and in my life? Is all this all that? It's now time for the sermon. Jesus Christ steps forward. The risen Christ takes the podium. And it says he came, verse 18, and spoke to them and said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Or to put it in everyday English, I'm in charge now. All authority, not some, not much, not most, the whole ball of wax, the whole kit and caboodle has been delegated to me. Not only in the sweet by and by, but also in the nasty here and now. He says, in heaven up there and earth down here, in eternity and in time, in forever and in history, all authority belongs to me. The word authority is an interesting word. There are a number of words used in the New Testament for authority or power. The main one that you find in the Bible is the Greek word dunamis, where we get our English word dynamite from, which has to do with this kind of explosive power, dunamis, dynamite, that which is just powerful in its ability to disrupt. But that's not the word here. The Greek word here is pronounced ekousia. Ekousia is a little different than dunamis. Ekousia means power in authorized hands. Power in legitimate hands. Ekousia has to do with the right to exercise the power. A policeman may have a gun and a criminal may have a gun. So both have power, but only one has a badge. It has to do with authorizing. So anything else that goes under the name of power that does not agree with Christ is unauthorized. In football, you have players who are younger, stronger, and faster than the refs. The refs are older, slower, and fatter than the players. The players have dunamis. The refs knock you down, the refs can put you out. Authorize authority, shut it down. Even though the players are younger, stronger, and faster because they have authorization. Jesus says, all legitimate authority is authorized in me. Anything that is outside, disagrees with, in opposition to me, is unauthorized. It's real, but it's not been authorized. And I mean all of it. There are no exceptions. All authority belongs to me in heaven and on earth. I have been legally deputized by the Father to the Son to run the show. This show I call the kingdom. This is the rule of God over his creation, because it's heaven and earth. It's the whole ball of wax, which the Bible calls the kingdom. And that's why you'll see in my material, kingdom man, kingdom woman, kingdom marriage, raising kingdom kids, kingdom disciples. Because this whole ball of wax, heaven and earth, only I have been given authorization to call the shots. I'm in charge now. So since that's how things are going to be run from here on out, to the group who was there, which now includes us, here's what I want you to do. I want you to make disciples. That's an imperative in the Greek, not a request, not a suggestion. I want you to make disciples. This is what I am commanding you to do, to make disciples. So anybody, any Christian who is not becoming a disciple and who is not making other people into the disciple is a disobedient Christian. Because the command, not the suggestion or request, is to make a disciple. So to make one, you gotta be one. So be one so you can make one. But interesting enough, he says, this thing is so big that I want you to make disciples of the nations. So I not only want you to affect people, I want you to affect the systems in which the people live, the structures by which they operate, the people in the structures, and the structures that influence the people. Because I want you to disciple the nations. So that raises a clear question. What does the word disciple mean? That I'm supposed to become and that I am. The word dunamis, the word tases disciple, was an interesting word in its usage. that Jesus uses here. Plato was a great philosopher. He developed a system of logic, Platonic thought. In this system of logic that Plato developed, he made a division between the physical and the metaphysical, between that which the five senses could relate to and that which was more in the ethereal, non-physical realm, and he created this division between the two. Now, if you didn't study philosophy, you actually operate by philosophy because that division today we call secular and sacred. It was a division between the two realms. He said that they are separate realms. A young student of his named Aristotle took Plato's thinking, and because he was Plato's disciple, that is, he picked up on Plato's philosophy, he began to develop a system around the thinking of Plato. We call it Aristotelian logic. So what he did was he organized a way of communicating this thought pattern of Plato, and he built schools. The schools he built, we use the term today, he built schools called academies. These academies were training centers for students to learn the thinking of Plato through the system of Aristotle, so that when they got out of the academy, they would take that thinking into their world. So the word disciple meant to transfer a way of thinking in such a way that the transferees would take it, grab it, and inculcate it into their worldview in whatever they did. So if you graduated from Aristotle's academy and you became a teacher, you became a teacher with Plato's thinking. If you became a doctor, you became a doctor with Plato's thinking. If you became a lawyer, you became a lawyer with Plato's thinking, because to be discipled meant to be influenced in the philosophy and the worldview of your teacher. When they graduated from these schools, they entered into the then known world, which was run by Rome. But Plato and Aristotle are Greek philosophers. The world was run by Rome, but they are learning to think like Greeks. So when they learn to think like Greeks and wind up into the Roman world, they bring Greek thinking into Rome. You called it in your history class the Hellenization of Rome, where Rome was the military power, but Greek controlled the culture. Jesus uses this word to say, I want to train a generation of my followers in my thinking, in my worldview. Their job is to learn my thinking and my worldview and transfer it into their world. Their world is not my world. Rome is not Greece. Their world is not my world, but I want my thinking to be in that world. And for my thinking to be in their world, there must be a transfer of thought. And the process of transferring this thought is the new transferring the. That's why there is so much not being to the kingdom. Messages all around the world. I'll mess like this. I get up one Sunday morning and I preach a message to our local congregation in Dallas. That message is recorded on a master recorder, a master CD recorder. It captures my master CD is then taken over to our national MIDI, is then put on a master duplicator. Plugged into the master duplicator are slave units. These slave units run so that there are now copies of the master. The copies of the master are then sent to people who want our messages every week or want our messages every month or who order a certain series because they've heard it on the radio or whatever. So the copies are then sent. When a person receives a copy, it's a copy of the master. Now, there's only one master, but there are many copies. But the copy is so much like the master, you could confuse it for the master because it's a replication of the master. What Jesus Christ is calling for is for him to run off on you and me and us in such a way that people can confuse you for the master. Because you are a replica of the master. Because through the process of discipleship, his thinking has run off on you in the foreign world in which you live, work, play, raise families. My son, Anthony Jr., my third child but oldest boy, some of you I know are familiar with his music and saw him on The Voice, and he's a great worship leader. When he first started singing, he's Anthony Jr., so he's named after me. When he first started singing, he would, he called me one day and asked me to pick him up from the airport. So when he first kind of begun the process of leading worship in various churches across the country, he said, "Dad, can you pick me up on so-and-so a date?" I said, "Okay, I'll come get you." This was before 9/11, and so you could walk up to the gate, and so I waited for him at the gate. He comes from the gate, we greet each other, and he's about the third person off the plane. So we're walking to baggage claim. Halfway to baggage claim, I stop. I look at him, and I said, "Oh, no, you didn't." He laughs because he knows exactly what I'm talking about. You see, if you're the third person off the plane, you in first class. If you're the third person off the plane, you in first class. He didn't have first class money. He didn't have first class ticket, but he had my name. I am a platinum flyer with American Airlines. So I knew what he had done. He had gone up and said, "My name is Tony Evans. Do you have any upgrades available?" She said, "Oh, Dr. Evans, we're glad to have you flying with us today." And what he did was piggyback off of who I was. Jesus Christ is inviting you to wear his name. To piggyback off of who he is, but that name has content tied to it. It's not just a name you throw out there. It is a name that represents a worldview that involves heaven and earth. And he says, and what I want you to do is make that kind of person. Become that kind of person and replicate that kind of person. Why? Why does he say make disciples after having just said all authority is given unto me? Because he only transfers his authority to disciples. He's inviting you to experience an authority transfer. The transformation of his legitimate authority to you. Individually, in your families, through your churches, and into the culture. The four categories of the kingdom. The missing key today is the disciples. And the reason I know the missing key is disciples is because we don't have any authority. And with discipleship comes a transfer of authority. They said I was chaplain of the Dallas Mavericks, and whenever I do a chapel, they give me four tickets to the game. So if the family doesn't want to go and I want to stay for the game, I'll tell some guys who I know, or guys from the church, I'll say, okay, you come with me to the game. But don't drive, because if you drive, you're going to have to pay $15 a car to park. Come with me. Because if you come with me, I have a parking space right in front of American Airlines Center where the Mavericks play, and I park for free. So there's no need for you to pay, but you got to come with me. When it's time to go into the arena, we're not going through the general public door. We're going through a private door. You get to go through the private door, but that's not because of who you are. That's because of who I am. Because you are with me, you get to piggyback on my rights and privileges of entrance. They will serve a four-course meal downstairs, and you get to eat for free at no cost to you. But you're not eating because of who you are. You're eating because of who you're with. You're piggybacking off of my rights and privileges. When the game is over and everybody is going and rushing to their cars, we're not in a hurry, because we're not going the way they're going. We're going out a private door to a private elevator, out a private exit, to a private parking lot, and we will be halfway home before most people have gotten to their cars. And that whole evening of activities will not have happened because of who you are. They will have happened because of who I am. You will have piggybacked off of my authority. Jesus is saying, you with me. And if I can ever get you to get properly connected to me, I can transfer to you and share with you my authority. It is the absence of discipleship that is the cause and the cure for the unraveling of our lives, our families, our churches, and our society. I told the leaders today that God is not going to skip the church house to fix the White House. We're worried about that house, and God is concerned about this house. Because God will only operate to the level of our commitment. So he gives us three participles. Go, baptize, and teach. To explain how to do the one imperative, make disciples. He says, first of all, if you're going to be serious about this thing, you got to go. Now, you can study go in Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic, Ugaritic, Syriac, and go means go. That means don't stay. What he is saying is, if you're going to be my disciple, you must be willing to leave the confines of your convenience. And everybody else is coming out the closet, you might as well come out too. Since you gotta be willing to go, you gotta be willing to. 1,500 people died the day the Titanic sank. But most of the boats, the lifeboats, were only half filled. 1,500 people didn't have to die. The 1,500 people died because the ones who were saved and safe didn't turn around. They were so happy to be delivered themselves, they weren't interested in delivering anybody else. If there is no witness, if there is no testimony, if there is no declaration of your identification with Jesus Christ, you are not a disciple. You may be a Christian, but a disciple is one who, right now we're in a nice holy huddle. A 100,000 people don't go in to watch the Carolina Panthers to see 11 men bend over in a huddle. They don't go to watch a huddle. Now, they don't mind a huddle as long as you only spend a few seconds in it. They'll let you huddle, but what they want to know is, what difference does the huddle make? They want to know, having huddled, will you now score? They want to know what you're going to do about 11 other men on the other side of the ball daring you to go public with your private conversation. See, it's easy to be a Christian in here, because there's no competition in here. Everybody else pretty much agrees with everybody in here. But we want to know, out there, if you were accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you, or would you be found innocent of all charges? He says, no, if you're going to be my disciple, you got to go. You got to go to your jobs. You got to go to communities. You got to go. This is a huddle. This is where the play is called. It's not where the game is played. Second participle, baptize them. And you don't mean get them wet. No. Let me tell you about the word baptizo, the Greek word baptize. From the Greek word baptizo, it was used of a dye maker. And when a mother wanted to make a dress for her daughter, let's say she wanted to make a pink dress, she'd go get cloth and take it to the dye maker. She'd say, I want the cloth to be pink. So the dye maker would take the cloth and he would dip it in pink dye, take off of the extraneous coloring, hang it up, and dry the cloth pink. So now he gave it to the mother, who now had pink cloth, so she could pink dye, so that it came up looking different than when it went in. Baptism was never meant to merely say you're saved. It was meant to say, now that you're saved, you're different. You've had a color change. You've had a different identity. That's why when he talks about spiritual baptism in Romans 6, baptizing to his death, that you might walk in the newness of life. That is, that you're marching according to a different drumbeat. You're operating according to a different worldview of what a man is, a different worldview of what a woman is, a different worldview of what a marriage is, a different worldview of what parenting is, a different worldview of what sexuality is, a different worldview. You have been reclassified according to a different standard of operation. Baptize them. So that now your chief identity is not your race, your color, your class, or your politics. Your chief identity now is your connection to Jesus Christ. I know many of you know my daughter, Priscilla Shire. She did the movie War Room and does the Bible studies. When she first got married to her husband, Jerry, when she got married, her name changed, of course. Now, up until that time, she'd been raised in my house. She was used to me. I took care of everything. She was my daughter. She got married to Jerry Shire. There was a name changed and a transfer of kingdom. She moved from my kingdom, my home, to his kingdom. She called me like a week after she got married wanting to borrow some money. I said, you better go ask your husband, because I'm not responsible for you anymore. All right? But see, she had gotten so used to living in my kingdom that she hadn't adjusted to the new kingdom she was now a part of. See, if you've been so tied to this world that now you've changed kingdoms to a whole nother, another king, dragging the old kingdom with you. To be baptized means to be reclassified. That's why you can't say you're a black Christian or white Christian, because then you make black and white an adjective, you make Christian a noun. The job of the adjective is to modify the noun. So if you got black and white in the adjectival position and Christianity in the noun position, Christianity, the noun, must always reflect the color of the adjective you just gave it. No, your Christianity must always be in the adjectival position. Your color must always be in the noun position, so that if anything changes, it's the noun of your humanity and not the adjective of your faith. You are to be identified and classified. Some of you may be Republicans, but God doesn't ride the backs of donkeys or elephants. What comes out, and he's getting ready to do some reconnaissance around the walls of Jericho. He's this huge guy with this army behind him. And so Joshua's mom ain't raised no dummy. Joshua comes over here and says, whose side are you on? Are you on our side? Because then you'll help us against Jericho. Or are you on their side? Because then they'll help, you can help them against us. So I want to know, as I do this planning for this warfare, whose side are you on? Captain looked at him and said, I am neither on your side, nor am I on their side. I am captain of the Lord's army. I did not come to take sides, I come to take over. While there may be political differences, they are never to interrupt the kingdom of God. God is the consummate independent. He is not ultimately obligated to anyone but himself. And neither should we be. Because you've been baptized, you've been reclassified, you're part of another kingdom. Like the Olympics that are coming up, Winter Olympics, you don't lose your individual uniqueness, but you represent another nation. It ain't all about you, it's about the nation that you represent. When you stand on the gold medal stand, they're not gonna ask you what's your favorite song. They're gonna play the song of the kingdom that you represent. You've been classified as a kingdom representative. He says, teach them, the third participle. What do you teach them? You know, all the theologies I name, pneumatology, ecclesiology, eschatology, you teach them Greek, Hebrew, Aramaic, you teach them exegetical skills, you teach them the name of the books of the Bible, you teach them, what do you teach them? It's like the name of this men's ministry. It says, you teach them to observe whatever I have commanded you. Don't teach them how to know it only. Teach them how to do it because they know it. You're not a disciple until your feet prove it. You're not a disciple because you say it. You're not a disciple because you feel it. You're not a disciple because you want it. You're only a disciple when you observe it. Until observation or action occurs, discipleship is not yet real. You're not a disciple because you say amen, praise the Lord, hallelujah, and raise your hand in the air like you just don't care. You're only disciple when the feet are moving. Teach them to observe whatever I have commanded. So you got to know what he's commanded, but he says, I want the purpose of you and the church is application, not merely information. Without application, the information lies dormant. Let's say you've got a life-threatening surgery coming up. You can live or die tomorrow based on how the surgery goes. Your doctor, to understand what we're going to do, he goes through all, explaining all the risk, telling you everything about the surgery. And he says, do you have any questions? Say, yeah, I got a question. How many of these have you done before? His answer, you're my first. But don't worry, I made an A in heart surgery class. Don't worry, because I was magna cum laude. You're probably going to say, Lordy, you crazy. Because when it comes to my life, I don't want to know about your grade level and your GPA. That's not, no. I want to know two things. I want to know, how many of these have you done before? Secondly, how them people doing? Because if you've done them 50 times and none of them made it, you still ain't operating on me. Because I want to know about your application, not merely your information. We're going to talk to the men tomorrow about being a kingdom man. That's about a function. Not about your plumbing. He says, until you observe, you can't be my disciple. It is information and application. You cannot audit the Christian life. An audit is where you go to get the information, but you don't have to do any of the work. You just go to church and get the information, hear the sermon. He closes with a statement. And lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. That brings us in it. We're still in the age. And lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. Now, you can't see it in English, but in the Greek construction, we call it the ego I me construction. The word I is written twice. So if you were to read it literally, it says, I, even I, will be with you always, even till the end of the age. So when they translated it in the Bible, they didn't write the word I twice. They just intensified the one I by saying, and lo, I, show enough me, for real, I. So it is the intensification of the one eye because there are two eyes. Okay? I, even I, will be with you always. So why does he stress himself as opposed to the other member of the Trinity's? Because Trinity, because the previous verse, he says, baptize him in the name singular of the three pronouns, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, of the Trinitarian Godhead. There's one God composed of three co-equal persons who's one in essence and distinct in personality. Father's not the Son is not the Spirit, but they make up the one Godhead. It's like a pretzel with three holes. The first hole's not the second hole, the second hole's not the third hole, but they all tie together by the same dough. Same divine nature. But he says, when it comes to discipleship, lo, I, not the Father, not the Spirit, me. Lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the age. Now, I know this verse gets quoted with a lot of stuff. You're sick, the Lord promised to be with you. You're struggling, the Lord promised to be with you. All that's true, but that's not what this verse is talking about. He's talking about, I will be with you for the purpose of sharing my authority. That's his point. All authority has been given to you. You will not see to rule in your life, in your family, and in your world, unless you are this kind of Christian. That's why I can say in St. John chapter 2, verses 23 to 25, many believed in him, many became Christians, but he would not commit himself to them because he knew what was in them. They had accepted him as Savior, but they weren't ready to live for him as Lord. They weren't ready to become full-time Christians, they were satisfied to be part-time saints, church attenders. He said, but if you will become a disciple, and you will invest in helping other people to become disciples, now you got me at another level. You experience me at another level. You experience authority at another level. You experience answered prayer at another level. You experience me overruling situations in your life, in your home, with your mate, with your kids, at another level, because I got all of you. So the reason we're running into icebergs and the ships are collapsing is because there's a missing key. And so there's missing authority, because there's the absence of what I call kingdom disciples. So the challenge that I give you tonight is, what kind of Christian are you? First of all, are you a Christian? Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your personal substitute? Because if he died on the cross for your sins, rose from the dead for you, and he promises anyone who comes to him by faith to receive him as their personal substitute, he will wipe away your sin, past, present, and future, and give you eternal life. That's his promise. But once you become a Christian, he now is asking, what kind of Christian are you? Are you a Christian operating by the worldview that you were raised in, that you grew up with, that the media tells you you are, that the society you live in informs you? Or are you a Christian who learns and implements a divine worldview for every category of your life? Not just the religious category, because in Christ there is no division between sacred and secular, because he is Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of both. So my challenge for you tonight is to change your approach. There's some individuals here caught in some besetting sins, some things that you want to shake, but you haven't gotten rid of, but you haven't made the full commitment yet, and you wonder why you don't have the power yet. There's some marriages here on the verge of divorce. Every day it's a fight, it's a war. That's because one or both parties have not properly come under the rule of God in your life for your role in that relationship. There are people who will go to work tomorrow who have absolutely no influence on your coworkers because you are a poor representative of the Savior. But you've heard something tonight that's grabbed your heart, your soul, and you want more. A young man just got married. He and his bride got in the car on their way to their honeymoon. For where they had to go through a strip of lonely road on a foggy evening. They were following behind a big truck, an 18-wheeler. So he wanted to pass the 18-wheeler, but because of the fog, he did not see the oncoming van. And there was a head-on collision as he tried to pass. His car was flipped up in the air and flipped over. He and his new bride were knocked unconscious. He came to first, and when he looked over to his bride, she was gushing with blood, blood everywhere. He knew if he did not find her help soon, she would bleed out and die. But where would he find help on this lonely country road? And that's when he saw it. Right above where the accident occurred was a little sign on the hill that said, Office of Dr. Bill Jones. How fortunate could it be that the accident happened in front of a doctor's office? He hurried around to the passenger side of the car. He picked up his bride. He stumbled up the hill with her and knocked on the door. An old gentleman came to the door. And he said, what can I do for you? He said, she's dying. She's dying. Save her. The old man looked at him and said, I'm so sorry. I stopped practicing years ago. To which this young man looked at him and said, listen, mister, you got two choices. Save her or take down your sign. But don't have a sign that gives me the impression that you can change things. Don't have a sign that gives me the impression you can heal things. Don't have an insignia that gives me the impression that when broken things show up at your door, you can turn it into something better. So either do what the sign says or stop fooling folk. As we close tonight, you have two choices. Stop practicing the Christianity you proclaim and become a full-time follower of Jesus Christ or take down the sign. But don't wear the sign declaring you to be something to impress folk, but you don't practice anymore. And so I want your head to bow and your eyes to be closed for a moment. And I want you to have a little private, personal conversation with God. And if you know where he is, I want you to get raw with him. He already knows it, but he wants you to demonstrate that you want him involved in it. I want you to get raw. Raw about your failures, raw about your sin, raw about the situation. And I want you to offer yourself as a full-time follower of Christ. I want to be your disciple, your kingdom representative on earth. If you're making that decision, I want to pray with you. Just stand where you are, and by standing say, yeah, you know what? I'm all in now. I'm all in. We're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to do any of that. But I want you now to go public. And by standing, I'm all in. No more just going to church. No, I am now a full-time follower of Christ. In my life, in my home. And all you got to do, Lord, is tell me what you want, and you got it. You got it. Lord, for the men and women who are standing all over this auditorium, you know their personal situations. And while we all can improve, I pray for them especially. And as they talk to you personally, and as I pray for them collectively, if any are not saved, may they come to you now and invite you to be their Savior by trusting you to be their substitute. And with all the believers now who are standing before you, Lord, offer you all of themselves so that you can give them the transfer of authority in their lives. And we will bless your name for what you're going to do in this house, in the Triad community, in this ministry, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you for allowing me to be part of your community so far, and again tomorrow. We'll be in the back to sign books for a while, and we'd love to keep in touch with you. If you just leave us your name at the table, we'll send you our teachings, and we'd love to continue a relationship, because this is our theme of our ministry now for the rest of my days, building kingdom disciples, and would love to stay in touch with you. Thank you, Roy Jones, for allowing me to be part of this evening. God bless you.
Wasn't that good? Rich. Somebody say baptize. To make kingdom disciples. You know, there's a lot that could be said in a moment like this where I and God has stood. We encourage you, those connect cards, and even if you didn't stand, if there's a way that you can fill it out, one of the things we understand is that it's so important that when people make decisions, that they are, our disciple is not one that we should live alone. It's one that we live in community. And so if you did stand, we encourage you to fill that out, and we'll have some time at the end in just a moment where you can pass those in. But we want to take a few moments as we worship to stay in that space. And I think there might be some things God is still doing, God is still saying. And so as the band leads us in the next few moments, I want you to just be in a spirit of prayer and a spirit of expectation, a spirit of anticipation of what God wants to do in the next few moments. Just kind of tarry with him for a moment. Dr. Evans is making his way to the back and preparing for those of you who might want to come and meet him and purchase some of the resources that he has. But I don't want us to lose the moment where God is speaking and God is stirring. Let's tarry with him for a few moments, if you don't mind. Amen.
Yeah.
couple things we want to share with you before we just kind of close in prayer. One of them is to, let's just first of all celebrate all of those people who stood, who made decisions for Christ. Can we just celebrate those decisions? We don't know what they were necessarily, but we know that God does. And part of the response, we encourage you, if you made a decision, once again, fill out that connect card before you leave so that we can stay connected to you. We can connect you to a local church if you're not, so that there can be a community to rally around you. A few just last parting words. As you depart, keep in mind there are some slick spots out there, so be careful as you walk. Also, remind you that we begin bright and early tomorrow. Let the men say amen. Yeah. Dr. Evans kicks us off in the morning, and so we have a full lineup tomorrow. We're excited about what God's going to do, and so there are still tickets. There are only a few left, but there are still tickets. Somebody shout, tickets. Yes, there are some left. So if you have not purchased a ticket, there's an opportunity for you to do so as you leave. We encourage you, if you're not already scheduled to be here and you want to, there's still an opportunity, so we encourage you to do that. Also, lastly, I just want to say, as I look around this room, there's a lot of planning and a lot of prayer and a great faith that it took to pull something like this off. And so I want to say to my brother Roy, as you look around the room, God is honoring what he spoke into your heart. He is honoring it. He is honoring it. And so keep all those things in mind. Be careful as you leave. Make sure if you haven't purchased a ticket that you join us tomorrow. Is there anything else I'm leaving out? Make sure you pass the connect cards to the middle. So if you're on the far right, you want to pass them to your left. If you're on the far left, you want to pass them in. We want to make sure we pick those up. There's just a level of accountability and stewardship for us as leaders of the decisions that are made. And so that's really important to us. And so if you'll help us with that, we deeply appreciate that. Anything else? I'm good. Father, thank you. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for the privilege we've had tonight to have an encounter with you. Thank you for your word that was preached. Thank you for the worship that prepared our hearts. And thank you, God, that we will not only be hearers of your word, but doers as well. So, God, I thank you that you are not only giving us the ability to conceive the dream and the vision you have for us, but you're giving us the courage to respond in obedience. So as we prepare to leave this place, may we leave better. May we leave refueled. May we leave recharged. May we leave reminded to go and baptize and teach in the name of Jesus. We say all that in faith. Let the people of God shout, amen. Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.
The Winter Blues Women's Event and attending this event, you can buy your tickets tonight. The tickets will be available for purchase out in the lobby.
You're never gonna let me down.
church.
You are good. You are good. You're good. Oh.
A couple things we want to share with you before we just kind of close in prayer. One of them is to, let's just first of all celebrate all of those people who stood, who made decisions for Christ. Can we just celebrate those decisions? We don't know what they were necessarily, but we know that God does. And part of the response, we encourage you, if you made a decision, once again, fill out that connect card before you leave. So that we can stay connected to you. We can connect you to a local church if you're not, so that there can be a community to rally around you. A few just last parting words. As you depart, keep in mind there are some slick spots out there, so be careful as you walk. Also, remind you that we begin bright and early tomorrow. Let the men say amen. Yeah. Dr. Evans kicks us off in the morning, and so we have a full lineup tomorrow. We're excited about what God's going to do, and so there are still tickets. There are only a few left, but there are still tickets. Somebody shout, tickets. Yes, there are some left. So if you have not purchased a ticket, there's an opportunity for you to do so as you leave. We encourage you, if you're not already scheduled to be here and you want to, there's still an opportunity, so we encourage you to do that. Also, lastly, I just want to say, as I look around this room, there's a lot of planning and a lot of prayer and a great faith that it took to pull something like this off. And so I want to say to my brother Roy, as you look around the room, God is honoring what he spoke into your heart. He is honoring it. He is honoring it. And so keep all those things in mind. Be careful as you leave. Make sure, if you haven't purchased a ticket, that you join us tomorrow. Is there anything else I'm leaving out? Make sure you pass the connect cards to the middle. So if you're on the far right, you want to pass them to your left. If you're on the far left, you want to pass them in. We want to make sure we pick those up. There's just a level of accountability and stewardship for us as leaders. Of the decisions that are made. And so that's really important to us. And so if you'll help us with that, we deeply appreciate that. Anything else? I'm good. Father, thank you. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for the privilege we've had tonight to have an encounter with you. Thank you for your word that was preached. Thank you for the worship that prepared our hearts. And thank you, God, that we will not only be hearers of your word, but doers as well. So God, I thank you that you are not only giving us the ability to conceive the dream and the vision you have for us, but you're giving us the courage to respond in obedience. So as we prepare to leave this place, may we leave better. May we leave refueled. May we leave recharged. May we leave reminded to go and baptize and teach in the name of Jesus. We say all that in faith. Let the people of God shout, amen. Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.
The Winter Blues Women's of Sin and attending this event, you can buy your tickets tonight. The tickets will be available for purchase out in the lobby.